Hello, everybody. Welcome to the newsroom of the Chicago Tribune. This is your Culture Lunch for Tuesday. We hope you had a good President's Day off, and I'm here with a panel of yakkers about matters entertainment, arts, culture, you name it. Joining me today, Scott Powers, entertainment editor, fabulous Nina Metz, entertainment reporter, and Mark Caro, entertainment reporter. So we've got a lot to talk about today. It is Yoko Ono's Yesterday, Yoko Ono's 80th birthday. That make you feel old, Scott?
A little bit. I mean, there's so many interesting concepts about Yoko Ono, but the one that I think is the most important to discuss is the song that they had just finished the night that John Lennon was murdered, Walking on Thin Ice, which to me set up about the potential for a whole new direction for John Lennon's music with her being a full partner. It's a terrific song. It was cutting edge. And it just was a tragedy, one of the many, many tragedies about his murder that we'll never hear what could have happened had they been collaborating onto the future.
Now, Mark, I think you once interviewed Yoko Ono.
A couple times. I talked to her last year, and we were talking about, and she's talking about how when she's turning 80, she was going to go on the road with a Plastic Ono band again. And I saw her at Park West a few years ago. She had an album called Rising. She has movies too. There's not a lot of action in them, but she had an album called Rising. It was like that's already like 15 years ago, but it was really good. I mean, she actually was a good performer, and we were talking kind of about how she'll be remembered, you know, eventually. And she's like, "Oh, I'm still known as John Lennon's wife." God, I can't talk anymore.
Also, the one who broke up the Beatles, more importantly, right. Not just the wife of, yeah. Right?
And the one who, I think, for all of you parents out there, the one who brought sort of John Lennon cute drawing onesies and, you know, crib bumpers and that sort of thing. I mean, really, like, one of her main jobs has been the merchandising of John Lennon and turning him into this cuddly guy. But I think also she wants to be known still as a peace activist and an artist, and those are sort of her sort of headlines, but she knows that the John thing, she's not going to escape. And she's not really running from it, given how much she's merchandising him.
Right.
All right, so it's Oscar week. Here's my favorite line from the musical Jersey Boys. The character of Tommy DeVito, they're about to get put into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and the Tommy DeVito guy says something like, "Every other award you can buy, but this one's from the people." Now, we know the Oscars are not from the people, but the question might be, can you buy the Oscars these days? Is it really, do you think, a reflection of the best movies out there, or has it now become a sort of a sense of, I don't know, what the gestalt is?
Now become?
Groupthink?
Just now.
More that way?
All of a sudden. It's a popularity contest. Well, it is a popularity contest. I think, actually, you could sort of argue there's been a lot of money spent on the Oscar race this year, but I'm not sure that you would necessarily say that it's been spent well, or spent in a way. I mean, Lincoln has spent a ton of money, and there's a sense now that Lincoln has kind of faded.
Spent money on what? Advertising, or
and like sending out, you know, booklets and things to like a lot of the guild members, not necessarily the Academy because they have more strict rules, mm-hmm. but trying to a lot of this is this sort of this prolonged campaign. It's almost like there's this Oscar season, in which all these guild awards lead up to the Oscars, and you sort of have to win the preliminary battle. So they can send, like Les Mis sent iPod shuffles to every member of the Broadcast Critics Association, Society, whatever it is, with all of the Les Mis songs on it in an effort to try to sway them. And Lincoln, there have been these signed thank you notes from Steven Spielberg and all this sort of thing. And there was a sense that when he had Bill Clinton introduce it at the Golden Globes, that maybe it was too much. He seemed too desperate for it, and so maybe that has hurt it. But the real story this year so far, it seems to be, is Argo, which Ben Affleck didn't get nominated for Best Director, and then all of a sudden he just started cleaning up on every other award there was. So is it because everyone likes him and because there's sort of this emotional sway to him, or is it because that movie is so flattering to Hollywood that people are like, no, I really did like it the best because it shows us solving a world crisis?
What do you say, Nina? Are they all nonsense to you, or do you care about
I don't know. I mean, I'm always curious. So it's sort of this group of roughly 6,000 people who are Academy members. Our sister paper, the LA Times, did a big piece last year trying to sort of sort out who are these people, because it's this grand mystery. They don't publish the names
and
of people.
And how old are these people? Though?
Well, okay, so the stats are were really interesting. So people under 40, what percentage do you think those under 40 are Academy members?
Let's guess 25.
2%. Yeah. The bulk, like 60-some-odd percent, 90-some-odd percent is over 60.
90.
Hang on, let me...
What do you say, Scott? Does that undermine the
more
whole
than
thing?
Half. I'm sorry, yeah, more than half. But it's predominantly white, predominantly male, predominantly over 60. Right. So And the Academy's whole thing is about, we want quality members, and so they have this whole very strict, recently, it hasn't always been so strict, but they have this whole sort of method of like, who qualifies, we want like the top tier people. Eric Estrada, by the way, is a member of the Academy, so I mean, it hasn't always been who you consider, you know, the strongest actors out there. But it's this sense of, who these people who are voting for movies, are they appealing to them specifically? To white men over 60, you know what I mean? And so why did Kathryn Bigelow not get nominated this year? Probably politics and the issues of torture that are portrayed in the movie, but there's very few women who are members of the Academy, proportionally speaking. So I don't know, it's always interesting to figure out, well, so who's voting?
Right, and it's, and the actors branch is by far the biggest branch as well.
It is.
So there's a sort of sense that if you have a movie that has good juicy parts for actors, that's gonna do better than one that doesn't.
Do you know what's interesting? So public relations people are members of the Academy.
Oh, yeah.
Which, I mean, I think is surprising because, you know, directors would be, actors would be, you know, designers, makeup artists, animators, but executives and publicists.
So, yeah. Mark Carroll, you're heading out to L.A. You're going to go to a few fancy parties.
I am,
fancy
Jones.
Parties. And so tell us what's that like.
One of these hangers-on sort of people.
What is your favorite Oscar party?
Well, the one that it took me a long time to get invited to is
invited
the Vanity
to.
Fair party. Yes, the Vanity Fair party. I get to go in at midnight, which is 2 a.m. here, so too bad. But it's really fascinating being inside the bubble because you're around all these really famous people, and you look over, and there's George Clooney, and there's John Hamm, and there's this. And so you feel simultaneously like important and like this little invisible speck because really, everyone sees right through you because nobody's looking at you. Everyone's looking to see who else there is to see.
Who have you seen so, drunk at a Vanity Fair party?
Oh, you know, I don't, you know, the rule of Vanity Fair
party. Who haven't you seen drunk?
I'll tell you a funny little story. There was one time I was there and I was standing and I came face to face with Rhoda Mitchell, who's this Australian actress who I've seen in, she was in Finding Neverland. And I think she's on that new show, Red Widow, is that what it's called? And the two of us, we're kind of facing each other in this bottleneck, and we kind of both got sort of tipped over onto this ottoman, and because it was just so crowded, someone was pushing herself over, and she looks at me, and she's kind of like, "Who's that guy?" And I look up, and I go, "It's Al Gore," and it was Al Gore, you know, kind of moving his way through the crowd, and Al kind of moves space now, and so we both got kind of toppled over to the, you know, and if it was like a meet cute in a movie, it was like you got toppled over by Al Gore, and so I got to meet Rhoda Mitchell.
For the last 20,000 years, you've been regaling Chicago Tribune readers with the Oscaro quiz.
Indeed.
Been a feature of the paper since 1911, I believe. You know, back in the Colonel McCormick days, you could find the Oscaro quiz. So what is the best question this year? What is the thing that's stumping readers? What's the most, you know, what's got you the most juiced up on the Oscaro quiz?
The best, well, I don't know. You know, they're all very fine questions, Chris. I'm not, you know, it's funny because I'll have to look and see what, which are the ones that really stumped people. But like George Clooney this year became the second guy who's been nominated for producing, which is Best Picture, for Argo, and also for acting and directing and writing. And so the question was, who was the first? Do you know who it was?
I don't.
It was Warren Beatty, but he's been nominated in each of those categories like 3 or 4 times. Like, it's not even close. I mean, he's been nominated for director, I think, 4 times, and writing for 3 times, and acting. So he's a stud, Warren Beatty.
All right, well, so pull out your Oscar quiz. Are you going to have your Oscar quiz at your Oscar party on Sunday then? Yeah?
Maybe. I mean, my Oscar party will be here at the Chicago Tribune.
Oh, there you go. Those are the best parties right here.
This is just great.
And for those of us who are not in Los Angeles this weekend, the Airy Crown Theater, the beautiful subterranean Airy Crown Theater at the gorgeous McCormick Place, is coming back online with Fela. I gotta say, it's like, it's interesting, Michelle Williams, as Beyonce at the Super Bowl, Michelle Williams is out on a sort of second company tour of Fela. It's a sort of changing destinies, you might say, wouldn't
yeah.
you say?
Yeah, I spoke to her last week for a piece that we ran
what
in the
she
paper.
Say?
You know, she's sort of made a career for herself in musical theater, You know, she did Chicago, she did Aida, she did The Color Purple. So, I mean, I think she's made a legitimate career for herself. There's no shame in it. You know what I mean? You don't have to be Beyonce to be...
We can't all be Beyonce.
Correct. Absolutely. She's a great voice.
And then the Airy Crown is this sort of weird venue that's sort of been on and offline for a while. Have you got memories of shows at the Airy Crown, Scott?
Boy, it was so long ago, I don't even remember what show it was. But you know, not the most entrance and egress-friendly place
it
that
is
there
not.
Is. Once you get in, it's a lot of fun. Fila is a great, great show, as you've written many, many times. It's a kind of a stand up on your feet the whole show and dance with the songs kind of show.
Yeah, the last show I reviewed at the Airy Crown was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles live musical.
They have it.
You know, I think I said that they don't lip sync.
Tony Award winning Teenage Mutant.
Yeah, and all these kids were like buying nunchucks in the lobby. So I think this looks better than that.
Well, so on a more sort of more serious topic, Ira Glass, famous for This American Life, has been turning the spotlight on violence in Chicago with a two-part series, which began this weekend, in which he had a great deal of access to the kids and the life at Harper High School. It's sort of interesting, I think, that some of these, you know, very prominent former Chicagoans, Glass was a former education reporter in Chicago, have got a very personal connection to the violence here, and now they've got, you know, good bully pulpits, the best one being the president's, but Ira Glass has a bully pulpit. What do you think, you know, they can add to this debate that we're all talking about here, Scott?
Well, art always, as we talked about last week, art always has a great way of shining a spotlight on current social and cultural issues and making sense of them or showing how much they don't make sense. And I think as our artists become more and more involved in these kinds of issues, we're going to learn more and more about, hopefully, the solutions to them.
Yeah.
You know, Ira Glass has always talked about how radio is an intimate medium. And it's true. It's like someone sort of talking directly into your ear, and it's a way to sort of do storytelling, long-form storytelling, that really sort of allows you to sort of get involved in the lives of these people. Among the reporters, I think three reporters were sort of embedded in this school. One of them was Alex Kotlowitz, who is a producer and co-creator of The Interrupters, a documentary that came out last year about Chicago violence. So, I mean, you're right. Ira Glass sort of is tapped into the people who are focusing on this, who know what they're talking about. What's interesting is that if you sort of checked out Twitter, everyone was talking about what an amazing, this was the first part that aired last weekend, the second part will air this weekend. Everyone's, it was an amazing series, you have to listen to it. And yet, you wonder how many people are hearing it because a few weeks ago they did an episode about doppelgangers. And Fred Armisen of Saturday Night Live was a doppelganger to Ira Glass. He basically did an Ira Glass imitation. And he was talking about how he had prepared this for Saturday Night Live. And it got cut, ultimately, because...
Nobody knew who Ira Glass was.
Because Lorne Michaels didn't think Ira Glass was famous enough. Or it didn't get enough laughs during the rehearsal. So...
I always have this
unlike those hilarious things they do put on the air.
I always have this memory of early on in Ira Glass's career when he was just a local figure. I remember sitting in the car, and it was a previous show about teenagers. And I remember the big takeaway was that teenagers spend most of their time trying to get organized. That they spend forever just trying to get, this is before Twitter and before, you know, various electronic devices. But I remember pulling the car off the street and sitting there talking, listening to him talk about how fascinating it is that teenagers can never get their acts together. So most of their evenings are spent just trying to find each other. It's a fascinating.
Having two teenagers at home is very true.
I mean, a lot of what Ira Glass brings to this, aside from his own know-how and storytelling abilities, is that audience that we're talking about. I mean, it's a very educated, smart, engaged audience, and they aren't necessarily exposed to these kids and these situations that he's reporting on. And so it is a way to open worlds up for people that wouldn't normally have that.
So our last thing, so the Wall Street Journal is reporting there's a whole new market for video gamers, and that is geezers, the idea of, you know, the Pong crowd. So I spent part of my President's Day morning with my kids, you know, at Nickel City in beautiful Northbrook, playing the free game Pac-Man while they spent all my money. So is there really a market now for, I mean, we've got some geezers on the panel, do you play video games?
As the most gray-haired member of this panel, thank you. No, I don't play video games. Just time is the enemy on that one. I did at one point, Peter Gabriel had a really interesting Myst-like game a number of years ago that I found a fascinating way to kind of wind your way through this story. But right now, no, no time.
Well, what are these geezer games, like first-person walker or something, where you're just kind of going, walking slowly down the street or something like that?
Well, the idea is you don't have to...
How much of a geezer is it?
Yeah, the idea is you don't have to deal with kids, I think.
Or it's just Bejeweled, basically. But, I mean, it makes sense in the idea that sort of Pong and Atari sort of developed in the 70s. So this is a generation, the first generation, that really sort of grew up with video games. Why wouldn't people continue to have a taste for it?
Yeah. Right. Well, and especially these retro games, obviously people like playing Pac-Man. And
right.
All right. All right. Well, that's it, folks. Get back to work. See you here same time next week for the Culture Lunch. Bye-bye.